Tiziana Lembo, I'm a field epidemiologist based at the University of Glasgow. While I'm presenting on behalf of many co-authors and institutions, I should emphasize that this research was very much part of Miriam Cassi's PhD at the University of Glasgow and Purbra Institute. Miriam is now based at the Department of Agriculture, Food and Marine in Ireland, but she still remains a very important collaborator of ours. So our studies on FMD in Tanzania initially focused on a number of livestock-wildlife interface areas in northern Tanzania, representative of a range of production systems, including pastoralists, agropastoralists, and rural smallholder systems. And this work was very much funded under the umbrella of the Combating Infectious Diseases of Livestock for International Development Initiative. Current work is much more restricted in space. We are focusing on high cattle density areas to the west of the Serengeti National Park. The very red means a lot of cattle, and also important pastoralist areas to the east of the Serengeti. And while we've received some support from various sources, I should really particularly acknowledge the contributions by MSD Animal Health, who have kept us going for the past 2 years since the end of the bigger grant. So this research so far has shown that the communities that we work in are extremely concerned about FMD. They consider it one of the most important diseases of livestock. They particularly report problems in lactating cows, which leads to significant decreases in milk production, as well as sales and consumption. But they also report considerable declines in traction capacity of these animals. In terms of the epidemiology of the disease, what we see is that the disease is more prevalent in cattle compared to small ruminants, and the main predictors of infection in cattle are very much livestock related as opposed to wildlife related, and they include age, the production system with higher exposure in pastoralist and agropastoralist communities. The size of the herd is important, the number of new acquisitions of cattle. But as I said earlier, none of the wildlife related factors that we looked at are significant predictors. In terms of the buffalo cattle question, both species are highly exposed to the disease, but we seem to see different patterns of infection. These are VNT results for the two species in a range of ecosystems, and the color coding relates to the World Reference Laboratory system. And what I want to emphasize only is that the most prevalent serotypes differ in the two species. It's O in cattle and SAT1 in buffalo, whereas the least prevalent ones are SAT2 in cattle and A in buffalo. So it seems that the problem is very much cattle related in these areas, and therefore control of infection in cattle should be a priority and offers a potential solution in terms of reducing the burden of the disease. And there is a high demand for this type of interventions, both at the community level and at the government level, as we know from workshops that we run in these areas. And we really ought to take this demand seriously, but we're still faced with major challenges. Surveillance is an enduring problem in these communities. Sampling is still very much research driven, and there are still unacceptably long intervals between sample collection and the diagnostic confirmation because samples still are sent mainly to reference laboratories. As a result, we still have a very poor understanding of the diversity of viruses in these areas with concerns in terms of poorly matched vaccine strains. We are only starting to understand the temporal and spatial pattern of infection in a very restricted area, and that's obviously quite important in terms of designing control strategies through vaccination. And to make things even more difficult, there are no polyvalent vaccines that would work against such a diversity of serotypes and variants. So in terms of spatial and temporal patterns, what we see is as follows. We initially, when we started the study, didn't have access to virus data. We only had access to serology data. So we chose a subset of samples and we ran through type specific serology. We chose animals that were young because we were interested in patterns of infection that were indicative of recent exposure. Richard and Miriam developed a model that allowed us to identify the most dominant serotypes causing infection. And we saw that initially, the most dominant serotype was SAT1 at the beginning of 2001, followed by O, and then SAT2 was starting to emerge. We then set up outbreak investigation surveys, so we were able to retrieve quite a large number of viruses from a quite large area to the west of the Serengeti and over a three-year period. And again, we saw that the outbreaks were caused by specific serotypes at given periods, with SAT2 being the dominant one at the beginning of 2012, followed by A from mid-2012 to mid-2013, and then SAT1 was the most dominant one from mid-2013 to 2015. Only one village suffered a no outbreak during this time. Another pattern that this plot shows is that there seemed to be a northward movement of viruses. So we looked as to whether there is some significance to this process. And the linear regression shows that the model explains for each serotype wave the number of days and kilometers north. So there is some significance there. We were also interested in looking at how frequently these outbreaks occur. So Miriam developed a probability of survival model. This plot shows the probability of survival, which means not having an outbreak over time, and this probability declines with time. And we also see a median time between outbreaks of 489 days in a number of herds that we've been able to follow longitudinally. I should emphasize that some of these herds suffered even more frequent outbreaks. Four of them suffered four outbreaks during a 2.5-year period only. And these outbreaks were caused by different serotypes, which again is consistent with this pattern of waves. So in conclusion, what we see in these areas is that there seem to be this serotype-specific dominance over time. I didn't have time to show that, but Miriam had a look at some data from the literature for southern Kenya, which is very connected to the area where we work in Tanzania, and the pattern seems to be consistent. And this is very promising in the sense that it might allow us to consider serotype-specific vaccination using, for example, monovalent vaccines that are much more readily available. Before we can proceed, we really need to try and understand that this pattern is happening more broadly across the region. And surveillance is going to be absolutely critical for us to be doing that. I'm not going to say very much about this because there'll be some specific talks that will discuss some of our progress in terms of field diagnostics and so on. But I just wanted to say that we're very keen on lateral flow device technology as a way of really improving surveillance in these remote settings. We've been testing a number of devices in these communities. They're very well accepted because they provide an immediate response. And also, we've been able to retrieve nucleic acid and the sequence data for basically all the devices that we've used. Just to conclude, just to emphasize where we think we should be going next. As I said, surveillance is going to be absolutely critical in terms of testing the hypothesis that these waves might be happening more broadly across the region. So we are working on trying to strengthen information networks using the increase in connectivity in these areas through mobile phones and WhatsApp platforms, for example. We're also starting to test strategies for deployment and recovery of lateral flow devices, but it would really help hugely if we were to think about upgrading the technology to be able to detect the serotype, not only to give a positive negative answer, possibly combined with improved capacity for molecular diagnostics and characterization in the countries. And also, just to say that I think there is a lot of scope for sharing our communal connections across Africa to really try and test our hypothesis more broadly. Thank you very much.
Tiziana, thank you very much.
I think
as I
we're out
say,
of time.
I'm going to leave the questions for after the session. So the next speaker, Jitendra, thank you, on the genetic and genetic variation of